I think what attracted me to this whole profession, other than the fact that I got a thrill out of it like a drag race, was the fact that I could lose myself in a character. I had the opportunity to live like 100 lives in one lifetime. The fantasies that I had as a child reading comic books. I'm into motion picture art. I mean, that's, as I said, my, to be able to survive and actually make a living in a business that allows you to explore all of these forbidden closets of your character, personality, whatever, openly, and be paid for it. That was a miracle to me. That was like a gift from God.
Hi, I'm John Phillip Law.
I was born in Hollywood. My mother was an actress. Well, I grew up in Hollywood, and Beverly Hills had just turned from orange groves into a big fancy housing project around the time I was born in the 30s. And the Sunset Strip, where I live, was Los Angeles County. It wasn't yet the city, because outside the city limits is where all the clubs were. The Macambo and the Trocadero and the Crescendo and the Clover Club. Well, I was totally unaware I was going to be an actor. My mother, being an actress, she left the profession. She went to the American Academy in New York and did mostly stage work, but she loved the business, and she married my dad, who was a deputy sheriff. And he was busy chasing Mickey Cohen up and down Sunset Strip there in those days. But my mother drugged my brother and I to the movie sets as extras. And my first impression of movie sets was just, standing in line, being yelled at, going to lunch, and waiting for this, waiting for that, hurry up and wait business. But I remember it very well. And I was fascinated with the camera. The first thing I wanted to be was a cameraman, because I always loved mechanical things, and I was kind of a shy, quiet guy. And my brother, my younger brother Tom, of Woodstock fame, Tom Law, he was groomed by my mother to be the actor of the family. On my street where I grew up, it was full of actors, Lee Tracy and Lee Marvin was living across the street, and Richard Cromwell, who lives up the street. Later on, Dennis Hopper and Vincent Price lived up there. Cole Porter was a neighbor of mine when I was a kid. All on Miller Drive, my little street. It's only about that long. My first thing I wanted to be in life was a gunsmith, because I was crazy about weapons. My favorite movies were Winchester 73, Colt 45, Carbine Williams, remember, who Jimmy Stewart, I think it was. I loved those movies. When I was 15, I got my learner's permit, and then I went from guns to cars. In LA, I mean, you could do that out there. I mean, we used to block off Sunset Boulevard right there between Sunset Plaza and La Cienega there, which wasn't even quite a quarter mile. And we'd go out there and have runoffs. We'd have two guys blocking the street holding the traffic, and just because if somebody chose someone off, to have a race, one of those things. It was rebel without a cause time. Well, all those guys I went to high school with were in that movie, from Frank Mazzola, Natalie Wood. Well, I was in the first and second grade at West Hollywood Grammar School with Natalie Wood. My classmates were, Ricky Nelson was behind me, David Nelson was ahead of me. But I mean, everybody, Fay Wray, Jason Robards, Glenn Larson, he became a big Hollywood television producer, did Knight Rider and all kinds of things like that. You know, my dad died when I was 15, and I became kind of the man of the family, and my brother, he got shoved into the acting thing, so he resisted it. But I knew that, I didn't think acting was a job for a man, you know. My favorite job was working at gas stations, and I met a million actors, and I grew up around them. I wasn't particularly impressed, you know, my mother was, but I didn't care. At about 57, and my mother always wanted to go to Hawaii. That's where I started my acting career, was in Hawaii. And I took acting as an art elective because I was afraid to get up in front of people. Well, I decided in Hawaii that I was gonna give it a shot. I said, well, geez, this is just too much fun. I went to New York and went to drama school in the neighborhood playhouse, and I got accepted because I knew a couple people had gone there. It was a rebirth. Just wonderful people, wonderful teachers, great history. Pearl Lang was my ballet teacher. Martha Graham was my modern dance teacher. Come On Strong. That was my first big shot, because that was a Broadway play. I mean, that's what everybody in drama school was dreaming about. How do you get in a Broadway play? And during that time, they were putting together the company for Lincoln Center Repertory Theater. And they were doing auditions all over the United States. So we formed this original company with about 30 people. And the first play we did was Arthur Miller's After the Fall. And it's the first time that Elie Kazan had worked with Arthur Miller since the big split they had, when he named the names and the Red Channels and all that whole period, that bleak period in Hollywood where all the writers got thrown out, you know? It was a terrible time. It was a little unfair. We were competing with Broadway. Kazan was doing things that he didn't want to compete with Joseph Papp in the Park, so I did the lead in a play the second year called The Changeling. He wanted me to do the lead in Marko Millions. Jose Quintero was the director of Marko Millions. You know, theater is an actor's media, and motion pictures are a director's media, really. The actors are just the paint on the canvas, you know. My brother Tom got a job for Albert Grossman, who was, he was the first big manager of Bobby Dylan, and my brother got a job as the roadie of Peter, Paul, and Mary. And Peter, Paul, and Mary kind of put Bob Dylan on the map because they sung Blowin' in the Wind and they started to sing some Dylan stuff. But I remember going to see Bobby in the Cafe Wah and the Cafe This and That down on McDougal Street, you know, 59, 60, 61 there, with Wavy Gravy, you know, who was then Hugh Romney. He was a beat poet, and then Bobby was the second act, you know. And I thought, geez, this guy's never gonna make it, man. You know, he's just, you know, he's a howler. Later on in the 60s, he just blew me away with his poetry, and he does to this day, and I still know Bob. During my summer vacation between year one and two of Lincoln Center, bunch of friends of mine from LA had gone to Italy, and they were a bunch of pool cleaners and mechanics who were bodybuilders, and they were starting to do these gladiator films. So I went over to see this one buddy of mine. My first trip to Europe, took a train down to Rome, went to see my buddy, didn't speak a word of Italian, and wound up in a, as a result of knowing him, that's when I met Franco Rossi for the second time. I'd met him very briefly in LA, and he was a first Italian director to do Runaway production in Los Angeles, and he did a picture called Smog. So the first film I ever did was called High Infidelity, Alta Infidelità. It was a film with four sketches. There was Elio Petri, Mario Monicelli, Luciano Salci, and Franco Rossi. And my sketch that Franco Rossi directed with Nino Manfredi and Fulvio Franco turned out to be the hit sketch. The other actors in it I worked with subsequently, there was Ugo Tagnazzi and Monica Vitti and Claire Bloom and Charles Aznavour and Jean-Pierre Cassel.
Anzi, se partiamo subito, sarà pure convinta di non avermi tradito perché è onesta. E quell'altro matto che mi ama? Ma io dico, non poteva essere una donna invece di un uomo. Mi sono sempre piaciute le donne alte.
C'è tutto, amore?
Sì, sì, c'è tutto.
Goodbye. Andiamo. Aspetta, Luigi. Tieni.
Grazie. Buon viaggio.
Arrivederci ancora.
Arrivederci. Come si dice? Good luck.
Grazie.
Addio, signor Ronald.
Addio. Io non dimenticherò.
Fammi partire, se no questo mi bacia.
I shot in English and they dubbed me into Italian. The only film I shot in Italian language, which I swore I'd never do again after that, was Polvere di Stella. Again, that was a film I did later with Monica Vitti. The second film I did with Rossi was a film called Per Tre Notte d'Amore. Then my third movie was in America. So then I went back, I got the job with Norman Jewison, did The Russians Are Coming, tried to do this, you know, with a Russian accent. I remember I went and I picked up the record of the Soviet Army Chorus and Band. So I took that and I listened to that album the night before and I got the part. For a year after that movie, I didn't work because people said, well, you know, he's a pretty good actor. Too bad he has that accent, you know? And Alan Arkin, he got an Academy Award nomination for it. But they thought I was from Eastern Europe, not Sunset Boulevard. So it was the question of doing it almost too well, you know? That was a big hit.
Excuse me, please. I am here still. Please, you should not be frightened of me. Here. You see? You. I give you gun.
I'm not frightened. Forehead's bleeding.
So, you know, I already had my career going in Italy because these first two films were successful. And then, the gladiator thing was phasing out. And I wanted to be a gladiator, but I wasn't, you know, I'm an ectomorph, you know, with big long arms like a spider, you know. And in fact, that was my nickname in high school, was Big Spider Law. So, too bad. A little late for Spider-Man. But Diabolic was perfect.
Death rides a horse. Bandits who killed five defenseless people made one big mistake. They should have killed six. Ever since he was a little boy, there was one thing he always wanted to do. Find four men and kill them.
So, I went back to Italy to do a spaghetti western called Da Uomo a Uomo, From Man to Man. The American title was Death Rides a Horse. And Lee Van Cleef, Cowboys and Comics. So I did this, first I did this Western. After, it was the highest grossing film in several countries, like Japan and here and there. But it was second only after For a Few Dollars More. It was shot in Italy. It was shot just outside of Rome, Elio Studios. And then we went for about a month to Almeria, Spain. And that was the first thing that Lee Van Cleef told me on when I was doing Death Rides a Horse. He said, John, because I was still green in the movies in the mid-60s, and here I was starring in this movie, playing the director who really wanted to be Sergio Leone. His name was Giulio Petroni. He kept calling me Clint, so every time he called me Clint, I'd say, "What's that, Sergio?" And he would, "Oh, excuse me, John," you know.
Turn around, Ryan. Defend yourself! Turn around, Ryan! Turn around, Ryan!
And then, of course, later on, I did this film where Rod Steiger played a gay in The Sergeant, and I think for me that was Rod Steiger's probably his best performance. I mean, he won the Academy Award that year for Heat of the Night, but that film, Rod Steiger does such a good job in The Sergeant, and it was produced by Robert Wise. And that was coming along, that was the late 60s too, that same period. I did Death Rides a Horse, Danger Diabolic, Barbarella, and The Sergeant, those four films over a year and a half period without ever stopping work. I stopped on Friday on Danger Diabolic. I started Barbarella on Monday.
Following me.
That's right. I've been following you. Yeah. What happened? What of it? I follow you again, too. You understand?
Swanee, I need you. I need you. You're everything that counts. You're mine.
No, you're wrong.
Not wrong.
I've been through hell, Swanee, and I'm not gonna go through it again. You're mine. No, you're wrong. Now, you listen to me. Now, I'm leaving. And I'm asking you, please, Sergeant, just leave me alone. Don't follow me, and don't come around me.
What?
Get away!
No, please.
Get away!
Get away! Get out! Get out! Get out! Get out! Get out!
I didn't do that, Swanee. I didn't.
I wanted to work with Jane Fonda and then this gang and Barbarella because I loved comic books. You know, I was always crazy about comics.
I'm dead.
No.
Where am I?
We're in the labyrinth of the City of Night.
Are you an angel?
I'm Pygar, the last of the ornithanthropes.
Barbarella, you know, said, well, you're going to play a blind angel, you know, and there was all these discussions. So when the wings arrived, they had suspenders. I insisted that they cut them off, and I put a 2x4 under the motor and squeezed myself up like that, and I did the whole movie like that, which I thought was more bird-like anyway, you know. Originally, they wanted to make my Barbarella wings white, you know. I said, no. I wanted to look like Hawkman in the comics. But I didn't want the parachute back holding the wings on. And that's the way the wings arrived. It looked like I was wearing a parachute. You know? know. And I said, what about the straps? Said, no, no, we're covering them with makeup. I said, never. At least I knew that much. And so we worked that out, and that was my choice. There was a big discussion for a day whether they should cut these rubber suspenders off and would it work. And I said, it'll work. I picked up a 2x4, stuck it right by my tailbone and went like that. And that was it, you know. And we did the film, and he said, can you do that for 3 months? I said, yes. Because I didn't want to disappoint the audience. I didn't want to disappoint the kid. As children, we pick up fantasies and they stay with us all of our lives. Vadim, he could get girls to do things that no other director could do. He treated the girls like jewels, you know, because he had a way with women. He was a female director. And that was the magic of Roger Vadim. I was working with Anita Pallenberg in that film. She was married to Keith. In fact, we wanted the Rolling Stones to do the soundtrack for Barbarella, but they didn't, Dino wouldn't pay the money.
Paramount Pictures and Dino De Laurentiis bring you the ultimate comic strip. Jane Fonda as Barbarella. Barbarella, the most beautiful creature of the future. She's inquisitive.
Have you seen an angel anywhere?
Observant.
This is really much too poetic a way to die.
Dangerous.
Armed. Like a naked savage.
Furious.
Where did you get those pills? Only Earth people know of those pills.
Bold.
Could you hand me a garment?
Practical.
You gotta get rid of this tail.
But more than anything else, Barbarella is love. And Jane Fonda is Barbarella.
Barbarella, Barbarella.
See Barbarella do her thing in Panavision and Technicolor. Directed by Roger Vadim from Paramount Pictures, a Gulf and Western company. Suggested for mature audiences.
I lived with Jane Fonda, Roger Vadim, the whole family, Jean-Claude Forest. We lived together for a year in a villa on Appiantica while he was preparing the film. And during that time, I did Death Rides a Horse. Then I came back and there was still more time before we started Barbarella. And Dino had the Diabolic and they were looking for the actor. And so I said, well, do you think you can do it, man? I went out and bought a bunch of Diabolic comics, just like I did for The Russians Are Coming, with the music and the Soviet Army, which, by the way, they used as a soundtrack eventually, you know. I'm sure it was Dino De Laurentiis' idea to put Diabolic on the screen. Mario Bava had very definite ideas, and initially I was thrust upon Mario Bava, I think. My first meeting with Mario Bava, because I didn't even read Italian very well, but I saw the comic, I said, well, this guy's, he looks like this. I can do that, you know, so I went. So I kind of glued my eyebrows up a little, and I kind of went into the meeting with Mario like that, and I said, oh, how do you do, sir? And Mario said, oh, questo diabolic. So, silly trick. The next step was the choosing of Eva Kent. And Charlie Bluedorn, who had just taken over Paramount, he was the head of Gulf and Western. They had just acquired Paramount, and he was there, and Bob Evans was running around the set, you know, before he was the big boss. Charlie Bluedorn had a girlfriend in New York who he brought over, who was a gorgeous model to play Eva Kent. She was absolutely gorgeous, but she couldn't say hello on film. It was a business choice as opposed to a physical choice in my case. So Mario Bava shot for a week and he was like this, you know, and I'm sure he and Dino discussed it. So they sent her home, and then now what do we do? We're a week away. And Roger Vadim tried to help, so he said, oh, Catherine Deneuve, and he brought Catherine Deneuve. And I shot for a week with Catherine Deneuve as Ava Kent. And then Mario Bava was still kind of like that, you know, because it didn't fulfill his image, but it wasn't her cup of tea and it didn't work, so they sent her home. And I think from the beginning, Mario had two girls in mind, Mary Lou Tolo or Marisa Mel. And so whatever happened there, he got Marisa. And Marisa came and we shot the scene again, and the chemistry was just bing. And Marie, I liked Marisa, she liked me, we had fun. I took her home for dinner out to the villa that night, and from that time on, it was just absolutely, we had a lot of fun. And Mario, he came to us, he was happy finally, and he said, now I've got my Diabolik and my Ava. He says, now I'm a dog of a director, but I know how to do the camera, so I'll make you guys look good, but you gotta help me with the acting. I mean, that's just the kind of stuff an actor dreams to hear from a director, because it gives him the confidence to do whatever the guy wants. Then he's willing to open up and be vulnerable. And there's where you get the magic moments on film. Mario Bava's concept of the film, really not Dino's. Dino saw the film as something like Raffles, you know, and he wanted to make an international film about a real master criminal. And instead of that, I was a comic book. Morricone's music is fabulous. I mean, again, I was surrounded by a cast. We have Michel Piccoli and with Terry Thomas in all those Carry On movies. You know, he was one of my heroes. Diabolik, it wasn't the success that they hoped for. A lot of people told me that was the end of my career, you know, because now I wasn't a serious actor anymore. You know, Tennessee Williams says that we're all prisoners in our own bodies. And I certainly was, because I was, you know, had a young face, but I was, you know, a head taller than anybody. That was, if I was going to play the son, I couldn't, because I would be taller than all the fathers. So I get these superhero things, you know, like I did the Docteur Justice for the Pif Gadget in France, and I did the Golden Voyage of Sinbad. I played Sinbad, and my Sinbad movie was. Even Ray Harryhausen said I was the best Sinbad, so I'm kind of proud of that, you know, because Ray is one of my heroes. Dilemmatus, Barbarella, the Sergeant, Michelle Piccoli, Jane Fonda, Morricone, Terry Thomas, Death Rides a Horse, Rod Steiger, Danger Diabolic, Mario Bava, Arjun Vadim, Marisa Mel, Jean-Claude Forest, Barbarella, Danger Diabolic, Barbarella, Danger Diabolic, Barbarella, Danger Diabolic.
It's a wonder, wonder woman. You're so wild and wonderful. 'Cause it seems whenever we're together, the planets all stand still. Barbarella, psychedella, there's a kind of cockle shell about you.
Barbarella, Barbarella,
dazzle me with rainbow color, fade away the dollar shade of living, get me up high, teach me to fly.
Peru, summer of 1970. Peru has painfully learned to live with earthquakes, avalanches, tidal waves, jaguars, and poisonous snakes. But Dennis Hopper was something else. At 34, he is known in Hollywood as a sullen renegade who talks revolution, settles arguments with karate, goes to bed with groups, and has taken trips on everything you can swallow or shoot. On the other hand, in the salons and the galleries of Los Angeles and New York, he is recognized as a talented poet, painter, sculptor, photographer, and as a leading collector of pop art. He is also, after 8 years on the movie industry's blacklists, the hottest director in Hollywood. Easy Rider, which cost only $370,000, is rapidly approaching a projected $50 million gross. In the process, it has polarized the new film audience of under 30s, generated a new school of talented young directors such as Jack Nicholson, Peter Bogdanovich, and Melvin Van Peebles, and established the style of a new Hollywood in which producers wear love beads instead of diamond stick pins and blow grass when they used to chew coronas. Yet to Dennis Hopper, Easy Rider was just a childish toddle in the direction he intends his movies to take. My next picture, he has promised his friends, is really going to be heavy, man. Then he hired a cast that included some of the most conspicuous individualists in Hollywood, among them Peter Fonda, Dean Stockwell, Jim Mitchum, Russ Tumblin, John Phillip Law, and Michelle Phillips of the Mamas and Papas. He hired Dennis Hopper as the movie's leading man, and he invited everybody to a location 14,000 feet above sea level in the backlands of Peru, a country where all major drugs, cocaine, speed, heroin, hallucinogens, are restricted but can in fact be purchased over the counter without a prescription. "Get all those cats together down there," said one Hollywood reporter, "and you'll have the wildest scene in the history of the movies." When I joined Dennis Hopper on location in Peru, I didn't recognize him. Since Easy Rider, he had dropped about 30 pounds of blubber and 10 pounds of hair. On the way to the set, Dennis talked. Man, the movies are coming out of a dark age. I mean, for 40 years, the uncreative people told the creative people what to do. But now we're telling them, like, forget those big budgets. The only thing you can make with a big budget is a big, impersonal, dishonest movie. We want to make little, personal, honest movies. So we're taking small salaries and gambling on the gross. And we're gonna make groovy movies, man. My second day in Cusco, Dennis gave me a curt, clear, precise of the movie he was about to make. It's called The Last Movie, and it's a story about America and how it's destroying itself. The hero is a stuntman in a lousy Western. When his movie unit goes back to the States, he stays on in Peru to develop a location for other Westerns. He's Mr. Middle America. He dreams of big cars, swimming pools, gorgeous girls. He's so innocent. He doesn't realize he's living out a myth, nailing himself to a cross of gold. But the Indians realize it. They see the lousy Western as a tragic legend of greed and violence in which everybody dies in the end. So they build a camera out of junk and reenact the movie as a religious rite. To play the victim in the ceremony, they pick the stuntman. The end is far out. By mid-afternoon, the game became more serious. Somebody made a cocaine connection and a number of actors laid in a large supply at bargain prices. There was a mountain of coke down there. As Dennis said, we might have been drug addicts, but we were drug addicts with a point of view and a work ethic. Dennis thinks of Easy Rider as a rehearsal of the last movie, the first picture conceived and created from start to finish by Dennis Hopper. This is the big one, he told me. If I fool up now, they'll say Easy Rider was a fluke, but I've got to take chances to do what I want. The day before shooting started, I realized he was prepared to take astonishing chances. When I asked how closely he expected to follow the script, he replied, I'm not afraid to start to work with an empty head. If you can't create out of the moment, you're not creating. Did he really intend to improvise a full-length feature film? All through the first day of shooting, he seemed to be improvising disaster. On the second day of shooting, there was no doubt about it. Every scene, every line of the horse opera sequence that introduces the last movie was improvised. In a matter of minutes, Dennis hooked up a story, a ballistic burlesque of a John Wayne Western that somehow managed to involve Billy the Kid, D.H. Lawrence, and James Dean. By noon, he had put about 15 minutes of film in the can, and most of it, as somebody said, was out of sight. The second week of shooting, Dennis filmed a party scene and I saw that energy flow. The setting for the episode was a desperately vulgar California tract house transplanted to the Andes. It did for the landscape what wax lips do for a face. All the time you could see John Phillip Law shooting on Super 8. As Dennis's power increases, it will be interesting to see how the movie industry copes with the man. Not long after I left Peru, he grabbed the local character who was bothering him and rammed his head through a glass coffee table. About the same time, Dennis spoke to a group of radical students who a few days before had exploded some Molotov cocktails in Cusco's principal plaza and made a statement the Junta considered inflammatory. A special government emissary was sent to tell Dennis he could either shut up or get out. He shut up, completed his picture, flew back to LA, announced his engagement to Michelle Phillips, and then casually added he needed a full year to edit and assemble the last movie. Brad Darrach, journalist.
Well, as far as Roger Corman, I don't know if you know Roger Corman, but Roger Corman has always been good to me through my career. I must have done 100, maybe 20 films for Roger. And Roger's hired me a lot of times. And I just had finished a pretty good film before that. We did Bloody Mama.
Bloody Mama.
With Shelley Winters, that's what it was. And I just finished that, and he said, we have a script that I'm going to do with John Phillip Law. I says, oh, I know John. He's going to play the Red Baron. I want you to play Brown. I says, what did Brown do? And then I started reading about how Brown was a pretty interesting character, you know what I mean? And so we went over to Ireland to shoot that film with Roger Corman, who, like I say, is a dear friend of mine. He's, to this day, he still is. Roger has a deal with the Irish government, I think, on taxes. Roger's that kind of guy. Roger make a good film for $100,000, and he'll make a pretty decent film. He's the only guy that can do it. Roger's shoots are not long, because that's how he makes his money. Maybe a month, but Roger will shoot a scene. Say you're shooting a scene and you're on your close-up. You go, okay, cut. You go, do it again. He said, no, I have what I need. So he can be very bruising to your ego sometimes. He said, Jesus, I did right my close-up. You know, he knew already where he was going with that shot, so why waste his film? Because he even used second pieces of film and spliced them together and stuff and got his film for free. And oh, he's such a genius. So we were over in Ireland doing this film, and it was a great, great film or anything like that, I'm not saying. But I thought some of the aerial photography was excellent. If anyone says, well, you didn't shoot it in the air, ask the people, the four people that died on that film. But one day, I had taken off, and I'm chasing the Red Baron. John's in front of me, and we're really in the planes. The pilot's in the front, I'm in the back. Red Baron's in front of me like that, and I got my machine gun set up right here, and the camera's right over here on the wing, a little Aries camera's on the wing. But in the dailies, you can see the pilot's head kept getting in the shot. You see what I mean? There's a little clip of this thing, so it spoiled the whole shot. You see my close-up, and someone came in my close-up. So Roger said, take the stick and lean out of the plane and fly. There's this little windshield here, the protection. Lean out of the plane and fly. Firing your machine guns at John's in front of me. Wah! And all of a sudden, this duck came through and hit the pilot in the head. Wham! He hit this water. The pilot's out cold, and we're underwater, and the plane is sinking and sinking and sinking. Now I have a parachute on and a seatbelt on. The plane's sinking and sinking. I went, wait a minute. I realized I was alive, and then I realized next, all the surfing I've done, I've surfed, I was fourth in the world. And I've had tremendous wipeouts where I'm just at the end, go up like that, you know. And I'm wondering what I'm going, this is nothing. This is nothing. I've been here 100 times. I took my seatbelt off, pow, pow, pow. Took the pilot's seatbelt off, reached over, took his seatbelt off, grabbed him by his head like this, and pulled him up out of the plane. The plane was completely sunk, completely submerged underwater. And I pulled the pilot up like that. And I went, Jesus Christ, I made it. It was like a terrible wipeout. I don't know if you went surfing, but wipeouts can be very severe. I've always surfed big waves. I'm talking about 15, 20 foot waves. The wipeouts are, you got to really stay together because you'll just do this freak out. And I was completely together, very calm and cool. And I'm holding this guy and the sound was gone. The sound of the plane is very, very loud. And all of a sudden, it was so quiet. You hear just like a bird chirping. And all of a sudden, everybody was gone. Because John and them had left. They were already flying. I couldn't see his plane anymore. And when I talked to him, he went, yeah, where'd you guys go? You know, you must have cut out this way, went out this way, because we're trying to get this shot. We don't come back. Half an hour later, I'm in the water for half an hour, and this wool sheep clothes is getting heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier. The fucking pilot's talking to me. This cuckoo thing he's talking about, he's gonna die and all this shit, and the blood is all, I thought he was gonna bleed to death first. How he never bled to death, I'll never know. But so I'm there holding this guy up, and finally I was thinking about kicking him away. That means when a lifeguard his life is in danger. See, I'm saving you, and you freak out so much, and you grab me around the neck, and all of a sudden, boy, I got more problems than you. So I was going to kick him away. I was going to kick the pilot away, and I just didn't do it. I just hung on to him. He was like on top of me, and I'm in water trying to keep up with all this clothes on. And he was just like over my shoulder like this. And I'm in the water. Here comes the helicopter. And we were there. And the helicopter came. And as he came down, the draft of the helicopter was pushing us underwater. It was pushing us underwater so heavy that I was waving him off. And the guy kept thinking, come lower. I don't know what he was going to do, throw me a rope. So finally, I decided to try and keep swimming towards the bank. And I got towards the bank of the river. And it was so muddy, it was like being on glass. And I still got this pilot. I'm trying to dig at the thing and get up. Finally, the crew got there. This one guy, I'll never forget him, and the funniest part about it all is we had to sign life insurance policies. John and I both did before we went up in the planes, just in case anything happens. I said, nothing's gonna happen to me. Give my money to the grip. So we're in the water. I see the crew come down. The guy I was gonna give the money to, he was so freaked out that they tied a rope around him. He started swimming out. Oh, God, stupidest thing I've ever seen. He started swimming out. Then he started drowning. Then they had to pull him in with a rope underwater. He almost drowned. Finally, I did get up that bank enough just to rest my head on the bank. The crew came and pulled us out. They took the pilot immediately in the ambulance to the hospital. They said, let's go. I went right to the pub. And the shot is in the movie, except for they cut. And when I was in that crash, I was smoking hashish from Afghanistan. So that was up to, man. So those days I was drinking a lot. And John didn't drink like me, but I had terrible problems with drugs. And John and I, our relationship was basically at work and stuff like that, because basically I drank so much. He was a pretty clean guy those days, you know. I couldn't tell you any secrets or anything about John, because I really don't know.
I'm Gordon Hessler, the director of the movie Sinbad's Golden Voyage. I never thought it would be a big success, but it was. And I don't think even the people at Columbia really appreciated the film, because at that time when the film was finished, there was a whole nuance of different kind of picture making, because America was changing in its thinking and so on. And it seemed, in a funny way, almost old-fashioned, you know, in a sense, when you look back at it. But seeing it just a few weeks ago, I was stunned how well it played. John Phillip Law was a big star at the time. He'd done Barbarella. Then it was just a question of hiring the actress. We did a screen test of three people in London. And we chose the English girl, who was very voluptuous. She was a model for Eastman Kodak. So in that time, we did a lot of work on the script to improve it, to make it a little bit less naive. So I was already at the script, but there's a good 8 weeks of preparation. At the time, Columbia was making all their films in Spain, where it was too expensive with extras and horsemen and castles to build them in Hollywood. And all their big pictures were being shot in Spain. You know, all David Lean's pictures were being done there, so that, you know, you inherited a lot of the crew. The Spanish crew was very well trained. They were trained by the Hollywood technician. And the set of the boat, the big boat, that was sitting on the outskirts of Madrid. And you could see telegraph wires and cars going behind. And it's a very difficult film to make. And I only had 8 weeks to shoot it in. And they normally took 14 weeks to do it, so I was under great strain to get it finished for them in that time period. Charles Chenier was a very important figure at Columbia Pictures, and he went on his own and founded a company based on Ray Harryhausen's talent. And the two of them had already made a couple of two or three successful films. Ray Harryhausen, on special effects, spent 1 year almost to finish the film. I'd already made another film in between before I could even start the editing. It took that, because there's one man in London, in a tiny little studio, working all by himself. Just incredible. Sinbad was his favorite picture. But John was a wonderful personality. He was a sort of original hippie, I imagine, when we first met him. And just enjoyed life, and wherever he made money, he bought a home here, and so he can go almost anywhere in the world and find a place which he owns. He should have today an enormous career, because he's still a very good-looking fellow, got the same deep voice, has the same personality. Gave you the impression that everything was sort of laissez-faire, but he really did go into the script. But he's a natural, you know, as you would make any criticism of him. He doesn't take his work seriously enough, and that may have been an impediment in the whole length of his career, where he could have gone up, because he enjoyed living, I think. You know, to have a career in this town, you have to be very aggressive and very pushing, and the competition was changing enormously, and then the whole motion picture business was changing. An actor like John would be put under contract, and if one film he didn't do that well, it still sees he has the star potential, and they'd push him into another one, and he'd get a pretty good salary for the whole year, but not kind of money that the young actors can make if they become a big superstar. Well, it could also be that he was in Spain at the time. You have to be in Hollywood.
Je m'appelle Mathias Sanderson. Je suis un cinéphile particulièrement attaché à l'histoire du cinéma français. Docteur Justice, le film de Christian Jacques, sorti en 1975, est tiré d'une bande dessinée à succès. Une bande dessinée homonyme, Docteur Justice, qui était publiée dans Pif Gadget, qui connut un succès gigantesque à l'époque, puisqu'il faut même imaginer qu'il y a eu un trimestriel dévolu tout spécialement à ce personnage. Trimestriel qui a commencé à sortir dans les années 73. Le personnage donc a été créé en 1970. Ce qui est intéressant dans Docteur Justice, dans la bande dessinée et le film aussi d'ailleurs, ce qui est intéressant encore aujourd'hui, c'est que c'est des produits qui étaient vraiment, qui ont été conçus comme des reflets de leur époque. Docteur Justice, en fait, quand Marcello, dessinateur, et Olivier, le scénariste, l'ont conçu, c'était un médecin volant, et il avait été conçu directement en référence au fameux French Doctors. Les French Doctors qui s'étaient fait connaître après la scission de MSF au moment du Biafra en 69, avec création de Médecins Sans Frontières, Kouchner, etc. Et donc Docteur Justice a vraiment été créé pour coller à cette actualité. Et ça, ce souci d'actualité qu'on trouve à la fois dans la bande dessinée et dans le film, est vraiment ce qui, à mon sens, est le plus intéressant. Parce qu'on voit vraiment évoluer le personnage. D'ailleurs, Docteur Justice, qui au début était simplement un judoka, très vite, il évolue et il devient un karatéka. Pourquoi il devient un karatéka? Ce qui est repris d'ailleurs dans le film, hein, avec John Phillip Law, c'est parce qu'entre-temps, dans les années 72-73, il y a eu Bruce Lee qui est apparu avec les grands succès de La Fureur du Dragon, Opération Dragon. Et donc, c'est ça qui est très intéressant, c'est que cette bande dessinée et ce film toujours collent à leur époque. D'où le succès gigantesque. On ne peut pas imaginer le succès qu'avait cette bande dessinée à l'époque. D'ailleurs, le succès même au-delà même de la revue Pif Gadget. Pour bien montrer comment il y avait ce désir de faire quelque chose qui colle à l'actualité, il y a le personnage que joue Gerd Fröbe, le double personnage, hein, celui d'un docteur fou. Il est visiblement d'origine suisse-allemande, du moins l'accent allemand n'est pas du tout éludé. Et à un moment, on découvre que c'est un médecin fou qui est inventeur de substances hallucinogènes. Et c'est une référence explicite à cette époque-là, dans les années 70, à Albert Hoffman qui avait créé le LSD et qui était un docteur suisse-allemand. Tout ça fait que cet univers conserve encore un intérêt pertinent aujourd'hui. Le choix de John Phillip Law pour jouer le rôle de Benjamin Justice, c'est un choix qui s'est fait par défaut. Initialement, le personnage de Docteur Justice dans la bande dessinée a été conçu avec les traits d'Alain Delon. Et initialement, il aurait bien aimé avoir Alain Delon. Mais bon, le budget était relativement modeste. Et en fait, je pense qu'ils n'ont jamais même contacté Alain Delon. Christian Jacques raconte que le choix donc de Docteur Justice a été relativement long. À l'époque de la préparation du film, ils ont publié dans les journaux, dans François, dans tous les journaux de l'époque, une fiche avec un portrait du docteur Justice pour demander, pour trouver d'éventuels postulants, parce qu'il fallait trouver en plus des postulants qui soient des karatékas, qui soient des acrobates. En fait, ça a été assez long, et John Phillip Law est arrivé en fait par défaut avec le succès qu'il avait eu précédemment dans des films comme Diabolique de Bava. Et aussi le fait qu'il avait beaucoup marqué les esprits dans son personnage d'Ange dans Barbarella, qui était une adaptation de bande dessinée également. John Phillip Law a été choisi par Christian Jacques, qui n'en était pas satisfait, mais qui, au cours du tournage, s'est montré un acteur qu'il trouvait particulièrement courageux. John Phillip Law voulait jouer toutes les séquences dangereuses sans être doublé. Il y a entre autres une séquence où il doit descendre le long d'une cheminée d'usine assez élevée, d'une trentaine de mètres, et John Phillip Law l'a fait à deux reprises sans défaillir, et donc voyant cela, Christian Jacques lui a demandé d'accélérer un peu le mouvement. Et en fait, John Phillip Law est tombé. Il y a eu un accident assez grave. Le tournage a été interrompu pendant 2 mois, et donc Christian Jacques saluait le courage de son acteur. Docteur Justice vaut, à mon sens, essentiellement pour le rôle, pour la personnalité et l'interprétation de Gerd Fröbe, qui dans le film est à la fois très à l'aise et très crédible dans son double rôle des deux méchants frères, l'un le savant fou et l'autre le cuisinier sadique. Parce que Gerd Fröbe, en fait, est un personnage qui apparaît beaucoup dans le cinéma français populaire, qui a joué dans plus d'une centaine de films. Il a joué dans Échappement libre, joué de Becker, il a joué dans Caroline Chéri, il a joué dans 100 000 dollars au soleil, il a joué dans Le coup du parapluie. Le fait que Gerd Fröbe soit polyglotte lui a permis d'avoir non pas simplement une carrière française, mais une véritable carrière internationale. Et surtout après son rôle dans Goldfinger. Nathalie Delon a été lancée par Alain Delon sur Le Samouraï, où elle est vraiment épatante. Elle avait épousé Alain Delon quand Delon s'est séparé de Romy Schneider, et il lui a permis de se faire connaître, et de faire connaître surtout sa sensualité, parce qu'elle est surtout très intéressante à ce niveau-là. Ensuite, elle a dû, entre Le Samouraï et Docteur Justice, tourner, je dirais, une dizaine de films, et elle a arrêté sa carrière dans les années 80. Quand le projet Docteur Justice est lancé donc en 1974 par le producteur Michel Ardan, c'est effectivement avec dans la tête le succès des Bruce Lee. Michel Ardan et Christian Jacques font appel à Roger Pachy, qui avait été champion du monde par équipe de karaté. Et donc ils ont fait appel à lui pour jouer un petit rôle et pour effectivement régler les combats, qui sont d'ailleurs assez réussis. Hein. Et par la suite, il a joué dans 2 films improbables de Hong Kong, Kung Fu Emmanuel et The Avenging Ninja. Donc non, il a pas eu une grande carrière cinématographique. Et donc il a plutôt servi de caution pour vendre le film. Son nom figurant en bonne place sur l'affiche. Rémy Julien, à l'époque, était le monsieur Cascade, en France et en Europe. C'était un ancien pilote de motocross et un chauffeur de poids lourd qui s'était fait connaître dès le milieu des années 60, quand il avait doublé Jean Marais dans Fantomas se déchaîne, le film d'André Hunebelle. Et il doublait la poursuite en moto. Ensuite, Gérard Houry l'avait repris pour La Grande Vadrouille, et il a commencé à partir de là à être réputé dans le milieu du cinéma et à connaître une véritable carrière internationale en faisant de nombreuses cascades pour les James Bond. Quand il arrive sur Docteur Justice, c'est déjà quelqu'un qui est très réputé et qui est passé maître dans l'art de la cascade. Le film Docteur Justice a été perçu de façon relativement mitigée par la critique française à l'époque, et son succès a été également très limité. Le film a été une relative déception même pour les fans de la bande dessinée, c'était quand même un des postulats de base pour faire entrer le public. quand Michel Ardan décide de se lancer dans la production de Docteur Justice, il fait appel à Christian Jacques. Christian Jacques ne connaît absolument rien au monde de la bande dessinée. Il est à l'origine du très grand succès populaire qui est Fanfan la Tulipe. Il y a aussi Un Revenant, qui est un très très grand film dans sa carrière, et Babette s'en va en guerre. Mais il est plutôt dans une phase descendante de sa carrière. Parce que Christian Jacques est quand même l'auteur de près de 108 films. À l'époque, au début des années 70, Christian Jacques est considéré comme le Cécile B2000 du cinéma français. Il fait partie du trio Christian Jacques, Jean Delannoy et Claude Tourlara, qui, à longueur d'article, est cassé systématiquement par les gens de la Nouvelle Vague. Mais bon, il n'a pas de scrupules, Christian Jacques, par rapport à ça. Parce que comme il le disait lui-même, j'ai un style propre à chaque sujet, je n'ai donc pas de style et je m'en flatte.